Welcome, friends, to this second day of our three-day program here in Southern California. I'm very happy once again to greet all of you and to say hello and to join you in a pursuit of our true knowledge of who we are, what is our true reality, where we belong. I was thinking overnight that I have been talking to you for the whole day yesterday, but it's all talk, no practice. We should practice some too. How many of you would like to join me in actual meditation? Okay, 3 o'clock today. Actual meditation, so that we know what we're talking about, so you can have some experiences and then build upon those experiences. This is not a meditation workshop. It's just a sampling of what meditation can do. But you'll get a sampling. When you go to intensive meditation retreats, which we are going to have now planned, you must have heard of them. There we'll meditate for several days, methodically progressing from one stage to another in about 5 days. And we did this experiment once. It was very successful. A lot of people got benefit from it. And we are having these four kind of an MRI or some kind of medical thing. Anyway, these are going to take place, but because we want the number to be small, and the last time we had to cut down the number to about 80, and about 200 people were disappointed because they wanted to join. So that is why we divided this into four of separate IMRs, and you can register for only one. So that gives everybody a chance. We take about 60 or 70 people each time. And that was a good group that we had. We did it in New Mexico. It worked very well. But today, in the afternoon, just as a sampling, we do some meditation to see how we withdraw our attention and carry it within ourselves to discover who we are. When we say, who are we? It raises the question, don't we know who we are? How are we asking this question? Don't we know who we are? The questioner should know. The questioner is the I, is the self. It's true, the questioner is the self. But who is the questioner? Who is saying, who am I? This is not being uttered by the body. The dead body can't say a thing. It's the life force in the body that's making it say. This vital force in the body, where does it come from? You might think that because we are alive. We are alive, and therefore we are having this ability to say, who am I? Yes, we are alive. How are we alive? What is life? What has put life into this physical body? We say we use our sense perceptions to see, to touch, to smell, to taste, to hear. These sense perceptions are functions of life, not life itself. Therefore, if some life force has created the body, it has also created the sense perceptions. So you can't say sense perceptions are life. They're just a function. Okay, let's move further. Then what about thinking? Is thinking life? Is it because we think and the thinking portion makes us alive? That is not true. Because all thinking takes time. You can't think a single thought without time. And yet, some functions life is performing in us which don't take any time, such as intuitive knowledge. You suddenly have a gut feeling, this is it. No thought is involved and you know it. Where does that come from? Where does sudden experience of love for somebody come from? No thought is involved, no duration is involved, no time is involved. But you suddenly have a great sense of bliss. You feel so utterly happy, sometimes for no reason. Where does that come from? So there are things happening inside us which do not involve thought. Therefore, thought must also be a process, a function of life. Then what is life? If you exclude these three things, exclude the physical body, excludes the sense perceptions that are working in the physical body, exclude the thinking mind that works in the physical body, then what is left would be life. And we call it the soul. When they say the spirit, the soul, they are referring to that part of us which makes the mind function, the sense perceptions function, and the body function. It is the real internal power of life, which we call the soul. The soul is, what is soul? Now that's a good question. When you say, who am I? The question boils down to this, what is my soul? What is the soul? If I am the soul, what is the soul? Now you can look at it, what could be the soul that could make the mind arrive, that could make the mind think? When the mind thinks, what happens? It becomes conscious of its thought. It becomes conscious of what it is thinking about. When the sense perceptions work, they become conscious of what they are seeing. When the body moves, it becomes conscious of what's happening around. So ultimately, you'll find that if there is one function that belongs only to the soul, it would be being conscious. Let us say, consciousness is soul. If you were to examine this proposition, that consciousness itself, the ability to be aware, the ability to be conscious is soul, then we have a clear idea what we're looking for. We are looking at the real source of our experiences, which is consciousness, which is lying within us. It's operating so closely in us that the mind can take power from it, the senses can take power from it, and the body can take power from it. When I divide these three, I divide them because that is how they are operating, one upon the other. Consciousness generates the experience of the mind and generates all experiences that we are going to have thereafter in time and space. The soul giving power, making it alive, the mind and soul then generate sense perceptions. So that perception of experience gets divided into different forms. Hearing becomes separate from seeing. Touching becomes separate from smelling, and so on. This separation is taking place with the help of the mind and the senses. Then you pack all this package into a human body, a material human body made of atoms and molecules, and a whole material world comes into being, because we can only experience what is available to us in this covered body. It's so simple. Now, of course, we have used words to represent these three covers. The physical body, the material body, creates a material experience of a material world. Supposing you did not have a material body, supposing it disappears, have you ever thought the material world that you experience will also disappear? Because your whole awareness of your material world is because of material body. The material body creates a material world, otherwise you don't have it. There's no proof it exists or not exists. When you have a material body, it exists. So there's a big correlation between having a physical material body and a physical material world. So we call it a physical body. When we go on to sense perceptions by themselves, not as operating in a physical body, sense perceptions as they operate by themselves. Can they operate by themselves, or they require the physical body? Not necessarily. If you don't believe it, I'll prove it to you. At 3 o'clock this afternoon, they work without the physical body. When you see the sense perceptions are operating, even when you imagine something, you imagine you are walking outside. Who is walking outside? Your attention has taken your sense perceptions to another location and walks outside. This body never participated. You close your eyes and you can think of anybody. These eyes are not seeing something else. The perception of sight is still there. You will see that the sense perceptions operate by themselves. And when a person dies, what happens? The sense perceptions don't die. They survive. That is why we say a disembodied spirit can see us, but we can't see it because it has no matter on it. It's not a material physical body, but it is a body because it has sense perceptions. It can see, touch, taste, smell, everything. So sense perceptions apparently are something like a body, independent, embedded into this physical body, which makes us feel the physical body has those sense perceptions. And we always say, I have these eyes, therefore I can see. The eyes are an organ of seeing, and they see in a particular way. They see because they say the light falls upon objects outside. Suppose there is complete darkness, you won't see, even with these eyes open. So the eyes require light to fall upon objects. So light falls upon objects, and that reflection, whatever object is there, absorbs most of the colors, the seven colors of the light, of the spectrum, but reflects some. And what we see is the reflected colors. I'm talking of science now. We see the reflected colors coming into our eyes. And when they come into the eyes, we have physical apparatus. We have the eyeball, we have the cornea, we have the vitreous humor, aqueous humor, and the lens, and they all make, they refract and make an image, an inverted image of the object we are seeing on the back of the eye, which we call the retina. The retina is merely an extension of an optic nerve. The optic nerve comes from the brain and comes down into the eyes, in both eyes, and spreads out into a retina. It's still a network. It spreads out to create rods and cones which can distinguish between form and color. So this is a procedure that the reflected image is hitting the eye and creating an image on the retina. What does the retina do? It can't see. It can only trigger a vibration, electronic vibration or electric vibration, which the nerve carries to the optical center in the brain. The optical center triggers some electrical charges there, and if you are conscious, you see. If you are not conscious, the whole process can take place, you will not see. So the ultimate cause of seeing still is consciousness. Let me put a proposition to you. Supposing the retina can make the pictures by itself. Supposing the retina is gifted as a biological ability to make images and make same images that we are seeing now, we'll see the material world exactly as we see now. We'll have no idea if it exists or not, because that's how we are seeing. The seeing will be exactly the same. Supposing the retina makes no pictures, but the optic nerve, the optic center in the brain makes that electric charge there, which then transfers to the optic nerve into the retina, and the retina will still make those pictures, and we'll still see things outside the same way. Supposing even that is not happening, supposing consciousness triggers something in the brain, because ultimately without consciousness we can't see. If consciousness triggers something in the brain, it will also create the same trigger to go to the retina, same trigger to make an inverted image, and same thing to see outside. Now, this is, which is the cause? Is the cause consciousness creating it, or the material outside things going inwards and creating this experience? Is matter the cause of seeing, or seeing is the cause of having matter? Old question. It's being asked for hundreds of years. Is the tree there because you see it, or the tree is there independently and then you see it? At some point in the preliminary stages, people thought it's very easy to give that answer, because the cause and effect, what is the cause, what is the effect, has a gap of time. One occurs first. Whatever occurs first is called cause. What occurs later is effect. So let's see what occurs first. When they try to study that, what occurs first, does the brain see first and then the tree comes, or the tree comes first, then the brain sees? They said maybe the tree has to come first, because you don't bring a tree in front, you won't see it. But they forgot that when you bring a tree in front, the bringing of the tree is also seeing. It's part of the tree. When they put the whole picture that you are seeing together, they found there is no time lag at all between the seeing and the tree. Not even a billionth of a nanosecond. They are simultaneous. Now, if it is simultaneous, it's left to anybody's guess which one is the cause, which one is the effect. But there is a more subtle answer. The materialists who have been arguing the material world has to be real before you can experience it. And the idealists, starting from Socrates and Greek philosophers and all the down to the current day mystics, they say no. The experience takes place first and creates the experience of things. The experience is causal. And outside sitting, we can go on experimenting. We are experimenting with that which we are observing. We are not experimenting with how we observe. Even Einstein, such a great philosopher who predicted things like gravitational waves which are coming to knowledge now, and things like that, and relativity, and that time and space are just expanding, and they are not static things. Things like that which nobody knew earlier. Even he says in his last memoirs, last writings, I failed to give enough importance to the observer's role. Today, they have given attention to that. Only last month, the physicist in a conference said, we believe that observation creates reality. This is not metaphysics, this is physics. How they said it creates reality? Because of that strange quantum physics stuff that came up, where they found that if you observe something, it changes. From particle to wave, wave to particle, it can be changed by observation. So if that can happen, which happened almost 80 years ago, and they've kept on looking at this, they find that if observation can change, it's giving a clue to scientists today that maybe there's a greater role in observation than we have been giving so far. But there's another way to check it out. The other way is, don't look from outside what's happening there, look from inside. Why don't you go to the source? Supposing we go to a movie and watch a movie on the screen. We are so riveted by what is happening on the screen. Tragic thing is happening, we cry. I must tell you a personal thing that I have never cried in my real life, but I've cried in movies. My children, when they accompany me, they carry extra handkerchief for me to wipe the tears. What happens when we watch a movie? We think the things are going on real. And it's a real scene taking place. Our whole eyes are riveted there. We don't take them as shadows. Supposing somebody says, these are shadows, this is not real at all. What are you looking at? No, but watch what happened next, as if something next is going to happen. Next is already there in the projector at the back. The projector at the back, film already pre-filmed, predetermined, pre-edited, pre-scripted, is in the film, and a light is falling through it and projected on the screen. If light fails, you can't see anything on the screen. If the film is changed, it changes on the screen. The light and the film are required to watch what you think is real, and they are not real. If you look back, they are not real, but they are the cause of reality. We are in the same state. The light of consciousness has to go through the film of the mind, which has a predetermined film laid on it, which we call our destiny, which we call prarabdha. That film has been loaded into the mind, and the light of consciousness falls through it and goes outside on a multiple screens, outside a multi-dimensional screen, and we are watching and we are saying, this is all real. And we are involved in it. We cry, we suffer, we suffer really. The movie has become a reality for us. Now, if this is so, and somebody wants to clear the doubt in a movie hall, he can say, look back. The projector is behind you, which is creating this scene. Mystics come and tell us, look, this movie you are watching is being projected from inside you, and just go in and see. That's what they are saying. If you can go inside and see where the projector is, where the light is, how it's operating, you get all the answers. Now, this is very interesting, that although the answer is so clear, that if you want to know, is this a movie that we are watching, which looks so real, because several dimensions, how have the dimensions been created? That's also an interesting question. How are we having several dimensions? Well, the movie is being projected through two lenses, not one. Two eyes. If we had one eye, the world would look very different. With two eyes, we see two pictures of the world, or we create two pictures from inside. Both ways, the same correct statement. We see two pictures and create a stereoscopic effect by combining the two pictures. You go on to 3D movies now, they put on artificial glasses on your eyes, and they merge two pictures on the same screen, and they look like a three-dimensional, and things start coming to you. The same process is going on automatically with us because we have two eyes. It is doing exactly the same thing. The two eyes are seeing two different pictures, and they try to merge them. And when they try to merge them, they merge inside on a notional place. Where do they merge? Have you ever examined? If I'm looking outside, if I looked only one eye, it would be this eye. This eye is different. If you look at your own finger, you can see, you can merge it or you can separate it. You can see two. Or you merge it. When you merge it, then where do you see it? You can't see it in one eye. It's a merged image. You carefully examine when you merge the two images and see it behind. It is being seen by you in the head, not in the eyes. How far inside? In the center of the head. Where is that point where you are seeing? That point is called a third eye center. Don't have to search for it. You are using it all the time. People say we want to search. Where is third eye center you talk about? And you are using it all the time by looking at this world. The merging of this. What happens? Merging creates dimensions, creates space, creates here and there, and the whole material world becomes a spatial time-space world. Similarly, when we want to check, is it really true what you are saying? Is this chair being created because we are looking at a chair? Then you can say, no, let me touch. This is a solid chair, I can't be making it up. We use another perception, touch, to verify that seeing is okay. If seeing is the same as creating a sense perception, the touch is also being created, the same nervous system in the same brain, in the same head. You can't be examining the reality of one perception by checking with another perception. No, is this cup real? Yeah, I can touch it. Is the water real? It's real, I tasted it. So it must be real. I tested it out. If it was unreal, I couldn't taste it. We are using different sense perceptions to determine what is real. To debunk this theory, you can go back to your own dream state. Supposing in the dream, I was sitting here and talking to you, and I was dreaming, and I have this cup of water here with me. In the dream, I say, is this real or am I dreaming? And I say, no, let me touch it. I will touch it. Let me drink it. I'll drink the water. I say, real. And then I wake up, it was unreal. It is the wakefulness state that tells you whether it's real or not real. It is a state higher than the state we are living in, which can only reveal to you what is real or what is not real. To try to make a guesswork of reality by using the very means which you are checking up is not going to work, because you are confined to a particular way of looking at or experiencing things, and you are trying to check within that. It will all be real or unreal at the same time. If this is real in my dream, everything else is real in my dream. Even me, I am real in the dream. When I wake up, neither I that I saw in the dream was real, nor this. But something was real. What was real? The one who tested this in the dream and the one who is awake is the same. The self is the same. Now that's the most wonderful thing that I have discovered. The self is always the same, no matter where, no matter when. No matter how high you go into spiritual evolution, no matter how many stages you have crossed to higher awareness, no matter how depth of dreams you have gone into, the self that dreams, the self that experiences is always the same. If the definition of reality, as I said yesterday, is what does not change, then the only thing that can be called real is the self. The self that experiences. The self that we just discovered by logic. We discovered self is consciousness. It's an entity that is conscious and can experience. It is, becomes conscious, and whatever it becomes conscious of becomes creation. So the self is the creator, and self is creating all this. But that is not the self we are experiencing, because we are using the self covered with three of these covers. When I mentioned the covers of sense perceptions, and said sense perceptions work independently, which we'll examine a little later, even more in the afternoon, that that the sense perceptions are by themselves like a body, and we call it the astral body, the sensory body. In India, they call it suksham sharir, or a fine body, a very fine body that consists only of sense perceptions and no matter at all. It's not a separate physical body that has other sense perceptions. When people say we have out-of-body experience, that's not the same thing. If you have an out-of-body experience by concentrating your attention on the heart chakra, which is also possible, that's an energetic experience. Your energy can create an image of yourself. You are still there. An image of yourself is created. You can move out and see the body and see that. It's just an image created by concentrating on an energy center. All the energy centers in our body are below the eyes. The centers of awareness are all above, behind or above. And that is why, if you want to study awareness, consciousness, these are not the centers to study consciousness. These are studies of energy. If you're interested in different forms of energy and how they work, how they sustain us, how they're sustaining the body, how they sustain experience, how they sustain life, study them. If you want to know what is higher awareness, what's the secret of awareness itself, what's the secret of consciousness, then stay in this physical body at the eye level and beyond. That's a big distinction. There's a big divider. The eyes are a big divider. And the eyes operate outside to start these chakras inside. And they operate inside. So in a certain description, they compare these chakras with petals of lotus petals. Eyes are described as two-petaled lotus. The two-petaled lotus is the starting point for willful yoga of any kind. Willful means with volition, with your own voluntary effort. Otherwise, somebody says, I was sleeping, I was doing yoga. That's not willful. Somebody says, I don't know, I was carried away somewhere. That was not yours. If you want to do with your free will, perform any kind of yoga, you have to be awake and start with the eyes. There's no other way. All the yogis of all traditions have started from the two-petaled lotus and then descended, generally through the spine, which carries about most of the energy, to the four-petaled lotus at the rectum, taken 6-petaled, 8-petaled, then 16-petaled, back to 2-petaled. That's how they rise. In the middle, they raise their kundalini at the second stage. They raise other levels. They raise out-of-body experience at the heart chakra. They raise unusual lucid dreams at this chakra, and they ultimately come back. We are found. Who did we find? We found ourselves. Who is ourselves? Ourselves is the body. Back again to the physical body. So this energy chakra can give you unusual experiences, but nothing to do with the source of awareness and consciousness. If you are students of that, of consciousness, which is our reality, because it constitutes the self, which is permanent, which is real. If that is your goal, then follow the path of discovery of who you are in the awareness areas, above the head, above the eyes, behind and above the eyes. When we try to go there, astral plane, why do they call it astral? Why don't they call it sensory? For example, I call it sensory also. It's a sensory body that operates, can operate independently of this. They call it astral because astral refers to the new sky that we can see with the new stars, stars which are like primary stars from which the reflection creates the stars and the planets and everything we see outside. The origin of those, the ideas that create stars can be seen inside visually. So we call it astral plane. And we call our body astral body. Then we find that we can go within that body, just like we go within this body to examine what's happening inside. If this all is happening in the brain, and it's all happening right in the center near the pineal gland or pituitary body, something in the center, if that's the place, third eye center, then what happens? Do we have a third eye center in the astral body? Sure. We always have a center. And where's the center where we operate from? Just like now. Just like now, we look out from there. We do everything from there. We think there. We decide what to do from there. In the astral body, we do the same thing. Now, let us say we meditate with the astral body. Not with this body. We've done our job. We found what is inside. Then we meditate with the astral body in the third eye center of the astral body. What will happen? You will become unaware of the sense perceptions. Process is the same. Same process that can make you unaware of this body by putting attention on the third eye center. The same process can make you unaware of your sense perceptions. And then what is left? Only your thinking mind and its power to perceive in one go without dividing into listening and seeing and all that separate. That power exists even now. But we divide it in order to make a sensory perception. And that perception comes back, and we find that is the cause of all concepts which become ideas in the astral plane and become material here. Everything is being caused there. It's being created there. It's the ultimate creator of the three worlds of time and space. So many masters have come and taken us there thinking it's our true home. The universal mind creating everything. They never could understand how could there be anything beyond where the entire creation is taking place from. So that must be our only reality. The universal mind from where everything is being created through the individual mind. When the mind is there, the cause of everything, we still are there, but no form, because there are no senses. There are no senses to divide up in the body, like we divide here. So therefore, we are a formless, or maybe a different kind of form. Some kind of a light form, or form where we can feel we are there, we are around, because of experiences, but we don't know what form it is. Some people say you can be like an oblong kind of a light. Some people have seen that. Some people have seen slightly smaller ones, stronger lights. But some kind of a light they associate with this. Light and music and song, some other descriptions I will talk sometime to you, exact descriptions of these. But there is the self still thinking, still conceptualizing, still making ideas thrown down in order to make them work, still creating, still having great creative power is the mind. And what is making that mind alive? The soul, ourself, consciousness. The fact that consciousness is not the mind has not been known to many people, not even masters. Masters have confused the creative power of the mind to be the source of consciousness. Unless you can separate the mind from consciousness per se, from the soul, you can never know the mind as a separate thing. But I mentioned a little while ago that the certain things the mind cannot perform, like love, intuition, bliss, beauty, joy, appreciation, these things come automatically, suddenly, without time. No thinking is involved. Therefore, there's something else doing those things. Apart from that function of soul, you can also know that some power is empowering the mind to be alive. And therefore, to go beyond that, no effort of the mind can work. No meditation can work. There's nothing more to go inside. There's no inside and outside. Then what do you do? That is why not many masters have gone. Even perfect living masters, we believe are perfect living masters. In history, you watch them. They call that their true home, the origin of all creation. They think the creation is everything here, then wherever it's created is the origin, and that's our ultimate God, ultimate creator. And they worshipped. Some worshipped even the creative power of the astral stage. Most of them went up to universal mind. But the fact that the soul is higher and above and separate from the mind were discovered by a few people. And those are the ones I recognize as a perfect living master. Because even the mind and time and space work together, even the mind has a life. The mind also dies. At a certain point, millions of years, but it dies. The astral self lives for thousands of years, but dies. They are finite. Soul is immortal. It's beyond time, and therefore it's immortal. When there's no time, it has to be immortal, eternal. Now, to be able to rise from the level of the mind into a spiritual level, that's the true spiritual level, where the spirit alone exists, the soul alone exists, to rise from that, something totally unknown to our mind must pull us. You can't push yourself any higher. Something must pull us. What is the most pulling force that exists in all these levels? It's the power of love, the power of unconditional love. When you experience unconditional love, it pulls you like nothing else. It can even subdue a doubting mind. The power of love is the strongest power. It has to be pure, unconditional. If it is based upon give and take, what have you done for me lately, that stuff, then of course it doesn't work, because that's a business transaction. And if it is, I love you, do you love me? No, I don't, then I also hate you. Not that kind of love. Not the word love. Love where the lover forgets himself or herself. The beloved occupies the mind. Beloved occupies thoughts. Beloved occupies attention. And therefore, the self is being replaced by the beloved. The self is identifying with the beloved. That's love. Secondly, unconditional, non-judgmental. Mind judges all the time. Good or bad, high or low. Soul never judges. It doesn't have to judge. It is not based upon deciding punishment and reward. It's not part of karma. It's not part of mental activities. The soul never judges. No soul judges ever. Therefore, when you go to spiritual level, there's no judgment at all. Everything as it is. It exists planned as it is. And we can see how it's planned so well, perfectly. We can see from the spiritual point of view. Therefore, a love that comes from that level, from the spiritual level, is totally non-judgmental, unconditional, pure, and has the power of pull. Now that love must come from beyond the mind to pull us. When we say there are perfect living masters, very few perfect living masters in this world, first of all, there are very few because very few people want to reach that stage, want to go beyond their mind to our true home, into spiritual realm where there's no time and space. Very few people think like that. They just want to have some place where they can have a good time. There are plenty of places in the astral plane that give you a good time. The heaven's there, the hell's there, all kinds of things are there at the astral plane, which is sensory plane. But if you, only for those seekers who are seeking to go beyond their minds into total perfection of the spirit, these perfect living masters only appear for them. They come into our life by coincidence, and we suddenly discover them, and they come right when we are ready for them. Supposing we have had masters and have been old practitioners of meditation, but we didn't know how far we can go, and different teachers took us to different levels, and we were not satisfied. We said we didn't get more what we are really wanting inside, what the soul is searching for, it is not found. It has found what the mind was searching for, but not what the soul is searching for. They appear in your life. You can't find them. They have to appear. If you could find them, you are yourself above the mind then, because they are ordinary people. They are very ordinary people. They are more ordinary than ordinary people. Why are they so ordinary? Because to use the weapon, the instrument of love, unconditional love, they must be like us. They have to become like us. If they are flying up high, we can worship them, we can admire them, we can adore them, but we can't be friends with them. If they are equal to us, like us, then they can become friends, we can chat like friends, we become real friends in the physical world. Therefore, they are very ordinary and they remain ordinary. They live ordinary lives. They're born like an ordinary person, they die like an ordinary person, they eat, drink, everything is ordinary. But their one thing is that their level of awareness as human beings has reached beyond the mind, and therefore they are holding that awareness at all times, whether they are here or there. They are not like us seekers who say we had a great experience and then we are back into the physical world. Or I had a higher experience and I am not sure now I'm here. Was it a dream or was it real? It looked very real when it was there. Now I can't remember because I'm back into physical reality. They hold all realities and all illusions at the same time, right up to the true home, which is not even a soul, it's a totality of souls. One soul that creates the many, creates the experience of many. They hold that experience with them, and when they speak to us, they speak with that awareness. They speak with authority. They don't speak, oh, maybe this book says this, maybe I believe that could be a good possibility. There are no maybes and probabilities in their speech, because they're not speaking from learning. They're speaking from what they are, not even experience. They're speaking from what is in front of them right now. That's the big difference. And any of their disciples who can reach that stage becomes exactly like them. They don't come to improve your lives. They don't come to make you better people. They don't come to take you to different levels of awareness. They come to make you exactly like themselves. And that's why their goal is quite different. How do they pick and choose who to take? They have a very good system. The system was designed by you, yourself, by every seeker. The seeker designed the system at what we might call inception. There was no inception in time, but there was an inception. That's why we are here. The inception, at the inception, when we decided to have these experiences, dream-like experiences, dream within dream within dream, when we were willing to have different experiences, some of pure love by becoming the many, some of time and space by becoming the mind, some of dividing into sensory perceptions to see, eat, touch, taste, do different things, some to be a physical being in a physical world which looks very real when you're living in it. When we decided to have all these experiences at different levels, we knew the danger of getting caught up in these, especially as the design was to make every level real. We were using consciousness, you might as well call it the use of illusion by consciousness, but the illusion was not to create illusion, illusion was to create realities. And several levels of realities were created. When we did that, we were conscious of getting trapped somewhere. So we made our own decisions that if we are trapped, we should be able to get out. And we should, in that experience itself, generate an experience which should be the way by which we can wake up to our own reality. And therefore we settled at that time, at what point in time we'd like to, if we have an experience in time and space, at what point in time we'll wake up. And that's the point of time where in the destiny, in the events of destiny, we placed an encounter with another human being we call a perfect living master. He made the arrangement beforehand. The other way people describe to make it more easy to understand is that we left our own home, we left God, left our Creator, and not everybody left. Only few people, 10% of the souls that were in the many in that great ocean of consciousness, 10% said, we want to have experience. And they descended into these experiences. Before they came, they turned around. Some of them, not 10%, 10% of 10%, 1%, turned around and said, what if we don't like that experience and want to come back? And the Creator said, don't worry, I will myself come back to take you back. I will myself manifest to take you back. These look like different stories, they are the same, identical story. When we say a perfect living master comes in our midst, the same totality of consciousness has come in our midst and guides us to take us back. We create that totality, we create reality, observation is creating, we create the perfect living master. We create the body of the perfect living master ourselves. But the arrangement was made when we were not human beings, when we were not in the body, when we were not minds. when we were not souls, when we were just leaving from the totality. And we are now getting that opportunity to go back. We made the arrangement. It's nothing new. Looks new, but it's nothing new. We destined it like that. So we have made a good arrangement. Now, those who made that arrangement and the time they fixed is when a perfect living master appears in their life. And they are supposed to be ready to go home. In the course of preparation of the experience we are having here, we start preparing ourselves. We say, no, first step in preparation is, I don't think this is my home. I'm fed up of it. It's too messy. I don't feel I belong here. If you don't have that feeling, you're not ready. Your time has not come. If you say, I am enjoying this life, I am very wonderful here, go on enjoying. Your time has not come. A friend of mine once came to me in Boston. He said, why are you telling people that they need to go back home? Isn't this world good enough? See what the variety of things here is. I go for a vacation to Hawaii. I go, I've got a nice wife and children, and I have a big home, and I've got a lot of money, and I'm so happy. Why should I try to go anywhere else? This is my home. I'm very happy. I said, what I am teaching people is not for you. You go and enjoy. I'm very happy for you that you are happy in this state. After one week, he came back to me crying. I am the unhappiest man in the world. I said, you were very happy last week. What happened now? My wife ditched me. My son wrote letters against me. So-and-so did this to me. I am miserable emotionally. And all my wealth and all my houses don't help me. Nothing is helping me when these emotional things are striking me and I am so unhappy. Will you tell me how to go back home to a true home where such unhappiness doesn't exist? Most of us who come on this are unhappy, have had experiences that this is not our place. We are not destined, soul is not destined to have these experiences. It is coming for a short experience, just to have a variety of experiences at different levels and then must go back home. So therefore, the readiness depends upon what you destined, how much you wanted this experience. When you get tired of it, fed up of it, you are ready to go. First step. Second step, that you want to have something which your mind does not want. The soul wants something and the mind says no. The soul is trying to get something the mind doesn't understand. The thinking doesn't understand, and there's a longing for something. Something is missing. There's a void in my life. I don't know what it is, but I think about it. I've got everything that I need. I've got all the physical things that I have with me. I need them. Then what is the void? Most of the time, the void can be traced down to the absence of adequate experience of love. The experience of loneliness creates that void. Now, you'll be surprised how many of you don't even know how lonely we are, and that's causing so much problem. What is the problem that loneliness creates? The problem of loneliness is that we feel we are isolated. Nobody's with us. Everybody's busy with their own things. We are being neglected. And we don't know what will happen to us later on in life. We are insecure. We are frightened. We are full of doubts what can happen. We are afraid. All result of loneliness. Good sign. Somebody said, very lonely. I said, congratulations. He didn't like it. I said, you are qualifying for a spiritual path. If you don't have these feelings, if you don't feel separation, you don't feel that I'm not experiencing the unconditional love I've always wanted from birth, from childhood. If you don't feel that, you don't need this path. Then you just need to go around and meet more people. A lot of people say, we get satisfaction going to the bars. Very good, go to the bars. But the drinks that people want to drink inside is different kind. It's not available in the bars. And that satisfies. That will satisfy, because on this path, there is something very beautiful. We want to touch upon that. The beautiful thing is that the unconditional love that we are expecting, which takes away our loneliness, is offered by a person, a human being, where we can expect and we can respond to the love of a human being. The perfection appears in a human being, and the human being gives unconditional love. We are pulled by that, drawn by that, become friends with that, and that friendship, if it goes on, can become friendship forever. There's one little turning point which makes that friendship forever. And that turning point is called initiation by a master, perfect living master. What is initiation? Some people think initiation means teaching how to meditate. That's not true. You can learn how to meditate from anybody who has read the books. You can read your own books and start meditating. The method has nothing to do with it. Initiation is the establishment of eternal friendship with somebody. Somebody says, I am your friend forever. Till we reach home, till we reach beyond the mind. When a perfect living master says that, you are initiated. Whether he teaches you meditation or not. I remember an incident in the Dera with the great master, my master, Baba Sawan Singh. When he was coming out of his door, an old man came, very full of dirt, carrying a little bag. Later on we found out he had traveled almost a month on foot to come and see the great master. Because a month earlier, he had a dream in which he saw a man with a white beard. And some kind of voice said, come along. And he said, I want initiation. He said, come. He heard that. Maybe he heard that because they were in that village from where he came. Some followers of great master. He might have heard from them or seen pictures. Somehow this dream came to him and he set off. He said, I have to meet. They got the address. It is Baba Sawan Singh. The Dera was very far. He had no money. Very poor man. He could only walk, carrying a few of his things, stopping all the way. It took a month to come to the Dera. It was so far away. Stopping at different, they used to call sarais or different gurdwaras or different places where one can stay in India. That's how he came. When he reached, he was so tired, and great master was just coming out of his house on the door. We were outside just waiting like this to greet him. This man comes, he looks at great master from about 100 feet away. He throws his bag, runs to him, catches his feet and says, yes, now initiate me. What he said was, give me Namdan. Will give me initiation. He's seeing great master first time, except for the dream earlier. And great master says, what once again? First words, what once again? And then quickly catching him up, he said, oh, you were initiated when you left your village. Formality of how to do things, I'll tell you tomorrow morning. Next day, he taught him the five holy words to repeat. He told him how to listen to the sound. He gave him how to do dhyan of a master. He told him all three phases of meditation. And you find we were a little shocked. We thought the great master knew him. Till he told us the story, he has been meeting for the first time. Initiation is not teaching how to meditate. Initiation is establishing a permanent friendship with an enlightened, totally enlightened person, so that the enlightened person takes you. What happens because of that? If you have done little homework on this spiritual path, little practice because our mind wants practice. Our mind always believes that unless I struggle, I will get nothing. Unless I work for it, I'll get nothing. If you tell a mind, sit quiet, relax, and you'll get everything, how can that be? It never happened like that to anybody. We all had to work, struggle to get everything in this world, and we have to struggle to get everything inside. So the mind doesn't believe that. And therefore, we say, okay, struggle a little bit. Struggle a little bit, do so much meditation up to this point, and come up to a point where I'll wait for you inside. Because outside, you are in bodies, physical bodies. You will die, I will die. Physical bodies don't last forever. They are very small time span. And the bodies die away. But we won't die. Because our relationship is not based upon these bodies, it's based upon astral bodies, it's based upon causal bodies, it's based upon the soul, it's based upon totality. The idea of our spiritual journey is to become one at the end. And the two will become one. In the process, we'll enjoy the two all the time. Can you imagine that if you have that experience of an established friend inside you, who can also appear outside and inside at will, can you ever be lonely? Never. That's the beauty of this spiritual path, of having a perfect living master in your life. You can never be lonely. You are never alone. Somebody was telling some friends yesterday about an experience of a lady who wanted to leave the Dera, gate master, and she was going to a village alone in a bus. And the great master said, go, I am going to be with you. She didn't believe that he physically will come with me. So she went at a bus stop. She had to go to the restroom. And it was a lonely place. And she said, what have I got? I'm traveling alone, never done this travel by bus before. And I have to see. When she got down, she saw the great master standing just in the bathroom, to the restroom. She went. He said, I am with you. She said, oh, my God, please stay outside while I use the restroom. These experiences have taken place with so many people. Somebody who's present here said they heard me talk and they saw Great Master at the same time. Many people have seen Great Master who passed away in 1948. You can see them today. But a person who was initiated by Great Master has Great Master with him in form and as company, as a friend, 24/7. How can you be lonely after that? How can you be afraid after that? The other thing is, if you are able to go take your attention and your awareness away from the body into the internal awareness of an astral body, you realize what death is like. Because it's like dying. The process of withdrawing attention from this body and going within is identical to the process where we physically die. When we physically die, we don't die at once, though sometimes it looks like that. We die by our awareness of our body being withdrawn from the extremities. The hands and feet die first, the legs die next, arms die next, then the torso starts dying from the bottom. It goes up. And the person is still speaking, saying, will you please put my leg this side? Not knowing the leg is already there, not awareness of leg is there. You can see them in terminal cases in the hospital. They're talking like that all the time. You see people in terminal stages, they're explaining exactly how withdrawal of awareness taking place. Only when it goes to the head, when the brain is dead, the person is dead. The process of withdrawing attention in meditation is identical. You are putting your attention at the third eye center behind the eyes, imagining you are there. And concentrating your attention that you are there, you are there. You begin to forget where your hands and feet are. You begin to forget where your legs and arms are. You begin to forget where your body is. You become unaware of your body and you become aware of your astral self. Process is identical. It's been called dying while living. That is why I'll tell you a story. Before I ask for questions and answers, finally, today I'll tell you a story. Once upon a time, you heard the story, many of you before. So forgive me for repeating. I sometimes repeat stories. That's a sign of old age, you know, to repeat the same things. Once upon a time, there was an import and export merchant in India, and he used to go to Africa to import cashew nuts and things, and he used to take silks and so on from India. That was his business. But during his trip to Africa, he used to go through a jungle, a forest full of parrots, a parrot forest. So one day, while he was in that forest, he liked one of the parrots. He said, it's a nice parrot, I should take home. He bought a cage and put the parrot in the cage, captured the parrot, put it in the cage, and brought it back to India. There it fed with the famous parrot food, which, if you don't know, it consists of sharp chilies, peppers, those very sharp biting parrots like them. Some people like them too. So parrots like those chilies, and they like another Indian food they make with flour, and they put some jaggery, brown sugar in it, and some ghee, buttered oil, something, and they mix it. Parrots love that. So this parrot was fed with chili and churi, and he enjoyed it, and he danced in the cage, and he loved it. Next year, when the merchant was going to Africa, he told the parrot, "I am going back to your home. Any message for folks back home?" The parrot said, "Tell them, I am having good chili and churi, and I dance, and I am very happy in my cage." So the merchant went. After finishing his business, he went to the same forest, and he called all the parrots. He said, "Gather here, I have a message for you." So the parrots gathered, and he said, "You remember I took a parrot with me back to India? He sent you a message. He says he's enjoying his churi and his chili, and he's dancing and singing and enjoying his life in the cage." Upon this, one elderly parrot sitting on a branch near him got tears in his eyes, and he dropped down dead. The merchant was very shocked, disappointed. "Why should I have said something? But this parrot must have been very close to my parrot, that he couldn't bear to hear my message." Anyway, feeling sorry, he went back. When he came home, he told the parrot in the cage, "I did convey your message. But one of those parrots, an elderly parrot, when I told him that you are enjoying your chili and churi and dancing in the cage, he had tears in his eyes and he fell dead." Upon hearing this, the parrot in the cage had tears in his eyes and he fell dead. He said, "Oh, foolish merchant, if you knew that parrot couldn't stand the message, how would this parrot stand?" Anyway, disappointed, he took the dead parrot out of the cage and threw him out. As soon as the parrot was thrown out, he opened his wings and flew up and sat on the wall. And the merchant said, "You aren't dead after all?" He said, "No, neither is that one dead, the old man who died in front of you. He only sent a message through you. The message was, if you want to get out of this cage, die while living." It's a good story, they make it like that. Now I'll spend a little time with you answering any questions that you have written out earlier. Dr. George Aiken will read the questions.
Dear Ishwar G, how is it decided which karma is to be picked for the next life, from one's kariman or sanchit karma?
How is it decided which karma is to be picked for the next life, from one's kariman or sinchit karma? Let me explain a little bit about the role of these different karma. When we think with intention to act, we create a karma. When we act, we amplify the karma for a slightly different result, a bigger result. If we decide to kill somebody, but don't actually kill, we still committed a karma. There's certain punishment for that. If we actually kill, then there's bigger punishment for that. So the karma starts from intention to do something and is amplified if it is actually carried out. We are thinking of so many things and don't do it, but karma is still being created. If we say, "I want to help everybody, and I want to just go and serve everybody, I want to donate this thing to my church, to my temple," whether you donate or not, good karma has been created. If you donate, it's even better. You get bigger reward. So this business of karma gets into what you think is good or bad, and the consequences are proportional to what you're doing. They're not identical, but they're proportional to what you're doing. So you are creating this karma all the time, with all kinds of good thoughts and bad thoughts, good intentions and bad intentions. So at the end of life, you have a huge package. Your next life has to be made by a computer whiz guy. Some call him the angel of death. Some call him Dharabrai. Some call him the great computer whiz. I call him the great computer whiz guy. Because how he can fit in that you had reactions with so many people in one life, and you have so much karma, how do you put them together? You can't put them together in one place. So he tries to do his best through the latest technology, which is available in that astral plane, sub-astral plane, and he determines how much of that karma from this life can be fitted in. First selection is always from your last life, last karma. If it cannot be fitted, then the sinchit is brought into play. Then the reservoir is brought into play. So karma is what we are creating. Prarabdha is what makes the next life or has made this life the destiny. And sinchit is the reserve that cannot be accommodated in the next life and goes into a reserve. And from reserve it pulls to make a life. Karma creates consequences of events. Prarabdha, the destiny we get, is a series of events. Sinchit can be huge when we come in, is responsible for attitude. Attitudes are not made by events. Attitudes are made by the whole reservoir. And sinchit determines your attitude towards things, and the events are created according to previous events. Attitudes are very difficult to change. Events can be changed more easily because the events, the attitude, we call attitude sanskar. And it's a part of karma, but it's not exactly events. Sanskars, his sanskars are like this. His attitudes are like this. And the attitudes are remaining the same toward everything that we do. So the reservoir is responsible for those attitudes. And therefore, when one is initiated by a perfect living master, one of the benefits, maybe perquisite side benefits, that you get is at the very time of initiation, the entire sinchit is destroyed. Attitude changes right from there. Attitude changes faster, events change slower. The events of this life are not changed. The prarabdha is still there. You have to live that. Even masters live that. Even perfect living masters live that. Because that destiny is for this life. But there is no sinchit reservoir to pick out from for the next life. Therefore, if that person has to be reborn again to complete what he could not do in this life, the elements to make the next life has to be from this life alone, not from a reservoir. So the next life is always better. There's much smaller selection to make. And furthermore, that wizard, computer wizard, doesn't come into play, and the Dharmaraj is not there. If you are initiated by a perfect living master, the perfect living master comes at the time of death and determines what kind of life you should have based upon existing. And the main principle deciding the next life is how far were you able to succeed in your progress on the spiritual evolution, on spiritual growth. If you have not been able to complete, it puts you again, so you can catch up again and do it. Most people can do it in one lifetime. They used to do it in one lifetime. Now it takes a little longer because of more distractions. It's a very distracting environment nowadays. So some people take more time. But if you are initiated once by a perfect living master, this series of reincarnation must end with three more lifetimes, four in all. That's the maximum. And about four lives also, I want to tell you a little personal story. Four lives is the maximum. My dad, who was initiate of a great master, one day he was not present in the discourse in the satsang. He heard from the other satsangis that master today said that if you are initiated by a perfect living master, you will not have more than four lives. In the evening, we had a small meeting with great master. By that time, he was there. He came and joined that. In that evening meeting, he asked great master, "Master, is it true that this morning you said that if a person is initiated by a perfect living master, he cannot have more than four lives, four human lives?" Master said, "Why are you asking me, Lekhraj?" That was his name, Lekhraj. "Why are you asking me this question? You are going back on this life." He said, "No, I am asking that supposing I need five lives, are you putting a restriction on me?" He said, why would you like five lives? He said, supposing I hear sometimes master return here. If you come another trip, you're not going to leave me back in the Sachkhand. So it became a joke and everybody laughed. Then great master, addressing all of us, he said, this idea of four lives does not apply to everybody. If a perfect living master initiates you and you do your best to follow his instructions, you may not be able to do completely what he says because of your environment, your obligations, your duties, your prarabdha. Your prarabdha may prevent you from fully complying, and the naughty mind that you have trying to take you elsewhere may not let you do. But if you try your best to follow the instructions of the master, this is your last life. No questions asked. If you cannot follow at all and give up and say, no, I don't think, I don't believe, I'm better off here, then second life, where you will become like what is supposed to be the first life. It's only if you turn against the master and work against him in the same life and you initiated, you may come for third life. Only if you murder or kill the master, there's a chance of you coming in the fourth life. Four life is not for everybody. You should all be able to make it in one life.
Dear Ishwar G, what is our role and responsibility towards our kids, and how far are we responsible for their life?
What is our role and responsibility towards our kids, and how far are we responsible for their life? The kids come with their own prarabdha, own destiny. Their destiny and their destiny is linked with ours because they are born to us. They become our kids, so we are also part of their karma. Our karma and their karma ties up while we are together. Just like our karma is tied up with several other people, our friends, our soulmates, our workplace colleagues, our business colleagues, customers, clients. They are all part of a connection where both of us are having a karmic connection and we are fulfilling it according to our prarabdha and the prarabdha of the other person. It's tied up there. The kids' prarabdha is tied up while they are kids. As they grow up, their own prarabdha tries to take a different shape because they start thinking differently. They want to run their lives differently and they become very different. Even twin kids I've seen, identical twins, they look identical. We have a hard time putting ribbons on them to say who is who. Even they, as they grow up, become different, very different. So they have their prarabdha, their destiny. They grow like that. The role of a parent is to bring up the children as part of the destiny, to bring up the children as best as they can, according to their judgment and values. They should give the best to their children, bring them up. When the children grow up and can qualify to be called adults, it's their life. Don't treat them like little kids when they're grown up, which we have a tendency to do. The tendency, I was once in a posting in a hill station where a school was, a very beautiful school was there. The headmaster of that school was a bachelor. He was not married, had no children. And he had a very old mother. I was on the board of trustees of that school, so I would sometimes visit the school. The headmaster invited me to come home and meet his mother. So I went to the home. The headmaster was about 50 years old. And the mother was, I think, 80 years old. So when I went there, the mother said, my dear, did you have your sandwich today? She's telling the guy who's holding thousands of kids, taking care of them. But for her, he was still a kid. We have a tendency to treat our children, they never grow up for the parents. And we still worry about them. We try to take care of them. Not necessary. They are now leading their own lives. So at a certain point in time, we have to let go. Let go and let them lead their lives. They will lead their lives not according to all the time how you brought them up, but what their destiny is, what their prarabdha is. It's better to accept it. And this word I just use, accept, is a very important word in spiritual traditions, acceptance. Ultimately, you see that what's going to happen will happen. You can fight against it. This ought to be like that. This should be like that. But those oughts and shoulds don't work. It is what is. I once got a training from a guy who set up a, it's called EST, E-S-T, Erhard training. His name was Erhard, and he taught, and one of his main messages was, what is, and that's what A in French meant, EST. So that was a great lesson, that what is, what you think it ought to be is your mental thought, it's not the reality. Your physical reality is what is. And the sooner you accept this fact, the easier your life is. The sooner you accept the children have their own destinies and that you shouldn't worry about what they do, they will go through what their life is. You can't do anything. Somebody had asked me, somebody, my grown-up child is doing this, he's not going to do that, what I tell him. I said, please don't interfere in his life. The principle to follow in dealing with adults, whether they are your children or elsewhere, mind your own business and you'll be better off.
What is the meaning when you dream something that occurs in reality exactly as you dreamt it?
What is the meaning when you dream something that occurs in reality exactly as you dreamt it? It means it was a prophetic dream. It also means that it's a proof for you individually that everything is predetermined. Otherwise, you can't see it beforehand. There is a lady living in a town about, what's the name of the town of that, who can predict by dreams?
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, it's a city, DeKalb? There's some place about, I think, 60 miles from Chicago. There's a lady living there who dreams things which come out real, just like you have put in the question. Very frequently. She doesn't know how it happened, but she dreams. After a week later, it has actually happened. She can even dream earthquakes and so on. So that's a strange thing she has from birth. So she came to a conference where I was speaking. So she became interested and wanted to come and see me in Chicago. I had just come from India and settled down in the United States, was living in a small little place, and I was working for a small company to make some money in addition to my pension. So those persons, when we joined the business, suddenly grew big and they made a lot of money, which helped me also, by the way. And they bought a great big stretch limousine. They were two black guys. They thought cars were the real sign of how good you are. So they bought a big limousine, stretch limousine. And when that girl met me, I was a poor man from India, just come. But she had a dream 1 week before she was supposed to come and see me. And I had told her to come and see me in a small office we had where we worked. In the dream, she felt that she's going and a big stretch limousine has come and I've got out of it. She saw me getting out of it and that she was in the lobby of a big 5-star hotel. She said, there's a strange dream, but she recorded it like she was recording most dreams. After a week, the day she was coming, we told her, don't come to that office, come to the Hyatt Regency Hotel. She said, maybe the dream is there. She waited in the lobby, long limousine pulls in, they get out, and she opened the journal that she wrote in last week and showed me. I had this dream. There are a number of people who can have prophetic dreams, and they can dream something and it happens. Some are good dreams, some are not good dreams, but they happen. An earthquake is not a good dream. Some people had those dreams too. The prophetic dreams, the dreams are of many kinds. I could give you a long lecture on dreams, that there are so many kinds of dreams that we have. Basically, a prophetic dream is just touching your ability in the dream state to touch on the timeline where a future event has been placed. You just have a glimpse of it and you come back. Because the event is already there. As I told you yesterday, when karma is created, the timeline is drawn first. From birth to death, events are put on that all along. And they are there before birth. They are made even before conception in the mother's womb. The timeline drawn with the event placed is done first. That's why they say in India, Prahlabad pehle bana, pache bana shareer. That the Prahlabd destiny is made first, and then the body starts making from conception. So therefore, this destiny contains events which are already there. Once upon a time, people could touch that and see, foresee. They were very good fortune tellers. They had the ability to move. And I met a guy I mentioned yesterday who could tell 5 minutes ahead of what I was thinking, what I was going to think. Even that he could predict. Or even thoughts are events on the timeline. So these prophetic dreams come when you are able to do that. Most of the time people tell me they come accidentally and they don't know how they come. They come because of past life work done in meditation. That's why they come. And people who have that, they make good students on the spiritual path. And they make good, very quick progress also. So it's in a way, it's a good start for them to come on spiritual path. Then there are dreams which are just a continuation of what you have been seeing in the daytime. Those dreams are monocolor. They are not multicolored. They are buff-colored, like the skin. If you were to close your eyes and have light outside, you see the redness of the skin, the pinkness of the skin, buff-colored. That's the color of the dreams. The dreams that have no real significance because they're just a continuation of what you were thinking, and they go into the dream sequence, are like that. Then there are dreams which are very colorful. And they include two colors, blue and yellow, which do not come in the regular dreams. When you see dreams, beautiful, clear sky, blue, yellow and red flowers growing there. That's coming from an overlap of the physical and the astral plane. And you are actually having, some dreams can be so real. You say, this is real. And you come to know, it's a dream? No, it's not a dream. And then you wake up, it must be a dream. Even if you go to, actually to a higher level, when you come back to this reality, the doubt comes up, was I imagining? Was it a dream? It looked absolutely real. Lucid dreams come up, some kind of dream that is so real, having such things which you cannot observe here. And yet when you come back, was my mind waking up? Or was it real? When you actually, through meditation, have your own volition to go to those levels, then you determine and find out, oh, this is the same place back. Now I am sure of it because now I've done it, not accidentally, not when I was sleeping, but when I was wakeful, and from wakeful state I started meditating. Then there are also more dreams that are to pay off past karma. Karma can be paid off, can be created only in human life where you experience free will. Because if you have no choice, how can you be paid, punished or rewarded? So the experience of free will takes place only in human life. The rest are all paying off. 8.4 million species of life forms are there. And all those 8.4 million are to pay off karma, including angels, including the rulers of higher levels of consciousness. They're just spots where people go, including Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, which we call worship as gods. And they are also souls occupying those positions by good karma. Is all payment or receiving of goodies from the karma. But karma is created here. It can be paid off with dreams also, which is very often a good thing. Because when we wake up, we say, thank God it was a dream. But sometimes the fear that's created in the dream, sometimes lasts even when we are awake. So we are still paying off the karma. But when we say, no, it was just a dream, it's over. What could have happened, and this happens very often in the case of initiates of perfect masters, that a lot of heavy karmas are paid off. They all have to be paid off in dreams, and therefore they don't actually happen in real life. We used to say, this person has a very bad dream. Thank God he had a bad dream. It doesn't happen in real life. Sometimes we see an accident taking place in a dream, and next day we find we narrowly escaped from an accident that we paid off in the dream. So dreams are of many kinds, and prophetic dreams are where we can just touch upon a particular glimpse of something in the future.
I find it difficult to put my question into words which seem grossly inadequate. If God is, why isn't that enough? If God is love, and love requires a beloved, then God is not?
I find it difficult to put my question into words, but he has done it, I must tell you. It was difficult, but done a difficult job. I find it difficult to put my question in words which seem grossly inadequate. Now let me put the question, read it out to you. If God is, why isn't that enough? If God is love, and love requires a beloved, then God is not. That's true. If God is, what else do we need? I'll just replace the words now. I'll replace the word God with totality of consciousness. If totality of consciousness is there, why say anything else? It's just this, a total thing. Let me put me materially. If there's a huge ocean of many drops, it's a huge ocean, it's an ocean, then what? What does it need? It doesn't need anything to be an ocean. It is an ocean. If God is there. Then the question comes up, where did this word God come from? Who made it up? Did God come and say, I am God? Or did somebody out here in the physical plane make it? Trace back. God is a man-made word. Not only is God man-made, the concept of God is man-made. The whole idea of who is God is man-made. It's a mental game. When you talk of God, you're playing a mental game on yourself because you can't go beyond the mind. This whole question is made by the mind. The whole concept that I believe in God is believing in a mental concept of God. Nobody's seen it. Nobody's experienced. Now you can start defining God in any way you like. Now you can say God is, period. I accept it, all right, that's your definition. Somebody says God is love, very good. That's a good definition. God knows everything. He's a being sitting somewhere. I can go and sit next to him. God is living in space and time, and somebody can sit next to him, very good. You can go on making any definitions and give any attributes to your defined God. God has never defined himself. I have never found any evidence anywhere on this globe that somebody could say that God defined himself and said who he was. Therefore, all these writings, all these concepts, all these ideas are man-made. Somebody says, did God make man or man made God? Well, what we call God, man made it. But what God made, we don't know. But we can find out. The beauty is that what you are asking, what God is God is or is he more, can be found out. But you can't write about it, you are right. It can't be really fully described. Words are inadequate because God is not in words. There are no words available in any language that I know of which can describe God. You can put any mental description you like because all words are mental. It's a function of the mind to create language and words. It doesn't go beyond that. Now, when I say, okay, God is, period, I agree. He doesn't need anything. So what? Then what next? What next after that? Okay, God is. What about us? Is he here or is he not here? Is he with us or not? Is he separate from us or is he part of us? Are we part of him or he's separate? Let us say he's separate. He's sitting somewhere. All right, if he's sitting somewhere, let's go and find him. Where is he sitting? If we know exactly where he's sitting, then we can find him. Supposing somebody says God is sitting on a mountain top, I'll go there and find him. When I go to the mountain top and I've gone right up to the top of the Himalayas, almost all tops, all peaks, I didn't find God sitting there. I saw a lot of snow there. If somebody says, no, God is sitting somewhere else, okay, let me take a consensus of people who talked about God. What is the consensus? The consensus is God sits inside you. That's the consensus of all mystic saints, people who say they realized God. As their statement, okay, let's examine if their statement is right. They are not saying God is sitting in them. They are saying God is sitting in us. In you, they say. You find your God inside you. Okay, I want to find God inside me. So, how do I go inside? What is inside? Inside what? Inside my body? Inside my thoughts? Inside what? Maybe inside everything. Let's try that. Now you come to the real thing. Now what you come to, if you want to know where God is, and it is, you start with the proposition God is inside, then go and search and you will find what God is. And you'll be shocked when you find what God is. It'll be totally different from any concept you can make. Because God will be everything that you've ever seen, including all of creation. People sometimes think that when we withdraw our attention and go to our true home, that true home means a big, nice place. Nice palaces there. And we just enjoy ourselves. Yeah, that is a true home in the mental stage. When we go to the top of our mental stage with no body and no senses, we can enjoy that lot of space. So much space we've never seen here. And we can have good time there. If that is your concept of God's place and you want to go there, yes, people go there. But if you want to go to the creator of that space, if God is the ultimate creator, not creator of different levels of experiences, if God is the ultimate creator, then you must go beyond that space, must go beyond space and time. Okay, now we have a method. Sitting in a human body, we have a method to go to that space, stage by stage. We go there. What do we find? We find that ultimately we are nothing but units of consciousness, the ability to experience, which is leading to the whole creation. We are that. And we are so much enjoying an experience without time and space, in totality. And we don't know what to call that experience which puts us so close together and gives us so much joy and bliss. So we have to design a word for that while we are sitting here. We can't have a word there. Experience is there. So we use a word and spell it in English, L-O-V-E, love. It's just a word. Word coined here. Experience there. When we experience there, that the one can experience the many simultaneously because there's no time, we realize that totality can be called God, can be called love. So we don't need a beloved for love. We need beloved to experience love. Big difference. God is love. Go and check it out. If somebody can check it out and tell me it's not true, I'll change my mind. Let anybody come and check it out that God is not love and show it to me that God is not love, I'll change my opinion. I'm ready to change. I'm ready to learn. My experience is God is love. But even the experience of love, God creates beloveds within itself and then through consciousness throughout this creation. Love is the basis of the entire creation. And therefore God is love. And God doesn't need a beloved to become God, doesn't need a beloved to be love. It needs a beloved to experience in a certain way, a beloved. And certainly so when we are in the physical plane.
Once initiated and one fails to meditate in sufficient amounts of time, are we still under the protection of the PLM, Perfect Living Master, who initiated us?
Once initiated and one fails to meditate in sufficient amounts of time, are we still under the protection of the PLM who initiates us? If you are initiated by a Perfect Living Master, you're always protected, period. Otherwise, it'll become conditional protection. It'll become conditional love. When we say the love of a Perfect Living Master is unconditional, how can he put this condition? He puts no conditions. Let me tell you some more secrets on the spiritual path. A Perfect Living Master does not require you to do anything to take you back home. He will take you back home because he's initiated you, period. Your mind doesn't believe it. He says, okay, work. Meditation is for the mind. Meditation is for our attitudes. Meditation is for preconceived notions. Meditation is because we think we cannot get it without doing anything. Okay, do it. You didn't do enough, do more. How much did you do? 1 hour? No, do 2.5 hours. You want to see me inside? Do more. This is just a game. That means we have not understood what initiation is. Initiation is a promise. You are ready. And he's not talking to mind, body, or karma, by the way. None of them are involved in this. Though it looks like there has to be good karma to meet a perfect living master, that's part of your own evolution to that point, the karmic pattern. But when he says, I initiate you, that means I take full responsibility to take you back home, period. Once initiated, you're going to be taken back home, no matter what. It may take a little longer time. Again, how much time it takes is no botheration to the soul. It's a botheration to the mind. Our mind worries. When? Impatience does not exist in the soul. Impatience exists in the mind. The mind is impatient. Mind says, how can I prove it? Let me see something first. I must see something. And then I'll go on. You don't have to go on. You're initiated. Initiation is a very powerful, the most significant event that can take place in anybody's life. Initiation by a perfect living master, there's nothing like it that I have found anywhere in the world. The most significant thing that can happen to a human being. So that is not merely teaching of something like do this and you will get that. It's not that at all. But our mind wants to be taught. Perfect living masters are not teachers. They become teachers for the sake of our minds. They don't have to teach, they love. They can pull us with their love right up to our true home, which is what they will do. But we don't believe it. Our minds don't believe it. So just to make the rest of the journey, while we are in physical bodies, or in astral bodies, or in minds, just to make the journey softer for us, they are willing to say, all right, you do this, we'll help you in this, you do this, we'll help you in this, meditate like that. Observe dietary restrictions, observe these things. They make up a whole set of rules for the mind. Mind loves rules. You know that. I mentioned yesterday how mind loves classification, how mind loves to put things, 1, 2, 3, 4, yeah, I understand it. If you say the whole thing, yeah, it's, God is love, has no meaning at all. It's a big concept. A huge concept. You break it into portion that if you do this, God will show you miracle. When you go and pray to the Lord, Lord, give me parking spot, he'll give you. You say, God is real. I'll tell you what a parking spot. An Irishman had to go to an important business meeting and he couldn't find a parking spot. So he prayed to God. Oh Lord, it's an important meeting of mine. I don't see any parking spot in this parking lot. Please find a parking spot for me. I don't want to get late for my meeting. And if you can do it, I'll go to Mass every Sunday. And I'll give up whiskey also. A car pulled out. The Irishman quickly pulled in. Said, God, I found it. I don't need that. Yes.
If Master dies before getting to see the radiant form inside, before I see the radiant form inside, what happens?
If Master dies before getting to see the radiant form inside, what happens? What happens is you try harder. You meditate more. You say, I missed the bus, I must not do it now before I die. One has died, the second should not die. The master's died, disciple should get something before he dies. So therefore, you work harder. Or supposing your association with the master was only at physical level, your no experiences, or experiences external. You felt miraculous things happening, but all external. And internally, you couldn't see the master, you couldn't talk to him, he was not guiding you from inside. That has not happened yet, and the master dies. Then you need guidance. Then you can find or be found by another master. Just like, supposing you have a master who takes you only up to a certain point and doesn't take you any further. And you want to seek further, a perfect living master will come by coincidence in your life. Similarly, if you have had no experience at all, and you are losing faith, beginning to lose faith because you never had any inner experience, though you are very happy in the physical company of that master, then you wait and say, Master, you're gone, but my seeking is not gone, another master will come into your life. If the master was not perfect, a perfect living master will come if your seeking is perfect for perfection. It all depends on your seeking. So that is why people can find other masters. If they don't find master, they can find other people who guide them till they can find a master. So you're not ever lost. The secret of self-realization, God-realization, is seeking. Seeking within yourself. If you are a seeker, you will find. It is not your responsibility to really find, your responsibility to seek. It is a master's responsibility to be found by you. Or in other words, to find you. But we don't feel that he has found us. We feel we have found him. Just by chance, by coincidence, we found him. The truth is, because of our readiness, he's found us. And that is how seeking is secret. Keep on your seeking, you'll get a perfect living master. I do recommend to all initiates of any master that while a master is physically alive, try your best. Whatever is required, physical companionship, physical association with the master, attending more of his talks, more of his discourses, spending time with him as much as you can, so that he doesn't die and then you say, I didn't get it. Of course, if you're not initiated, but waiting for initiation and he dies, that's even not a good case. And I'll tell you the case of one of the perfect living masters in India, Sheikh Farid. Sheikh Farid was a perfect master, and his master was Sheikh Qutbuddin. Sheikh Farid told his son, when he was not a master, Qutbuddin was alive, he told his son, son, my master is growing old. He's a human being, he can die any time. Go and get initiated. And like all sons, he said, Dad, you know, I am still young, I have a lot of things to do, and I am busy with my own things, I'm busy with business, I'm doing this. He would dilly-dally all the time and not go. One day, Qutbuddin died. And the son was not initiated. The son ran when he found Qutbuddin is dead. His body was lying there before it was buried. And he shaved, because that was one of the requirements in those days to get initiated. They shaved their head and put their head on the feet of a master. He shaved his head and put his head on the feet of Qutbuddin, who was dead. And Farid is standing next. He says, my son, you have put your head on the feet of the man I loved the most, I respected the most. But it's too late. There's nothing in this body now. Master's left. You can get nothing. Even 1 second is too late. Even 1 second is too late. You should have listened to me. Of course, later on, he got initiated by his own father. But the story illustrates the importance of association with the physical form of a master in order to get to the stage when he can be manifested during meditation, and you can talk to him, get guidance from him at any time, which is possible. It does not take that much effort. I can tell you, people think it takes a lot of effort to see the radiant form of a master. No, I can give you simple tips at another time to how to get the radiant form of a master faster than you think you can get. It allows you to use your imagination, your attention, and your concentration, and all three will help you in that. So that's a good requirement. If you can do that, you're never without a master. You'd not even feel he has died. He'll be more alive for you after death than he was during physical time. Because physical time, you're always thinking he's there. You have to go there. You have to meet him. And in the radiant form inside, he's with you all the time, 24/7. You talk to him, companionship. He's a friend forever. So that's a good tip given by Farid to his son. Master's going to die. Better get something now. And one of the Western followers of great master once asked him, "Master, how often, as a seeker, should I meet the master physically?" He said, "The best is to meet him every day." He said, "Master, you know, but we live far away. We can't meet you every day." He said, "If you are living far away, then the best is to meet once a week." By the way, my grandfather, who got initiated after my father, was present there. The rest of his life, till he died, he met master every week because he heard that statement. But the Westerner continued, "But master, supposing we are living very far off, and we can't afford to come to you, then what?" "Then once a month should be all right." "Master, what about if we are living overseas, like I am living overseas? How often should I come and see you?" "Once a year should be all right." "Say, master, if we can't come once a year." Master smiled, said, "And wait for next life." He did emphasize the importance of physical association, because when we are physically present in the presence of a persuasive master, something happens to us. Something seems to be being removed. Some veils are being removed inside. Looks like some doubts are being cleared. Some answers are coming which are not in words. Like that question said, some answers are coming which are not in words. Some certainty is coming just by the presence. So these things actually happen to us. And the more ready we are for our true home, for the time to go back, the more they come. And if you're not fully ready, we are going waiting for three lives or more to come, then they don't affect us too much. You see, your master just made up a story telling us. I have passed through a stage in my own life when I used to think that masters just make up stories, that there's no such thing. I understand how that happens. An initiate has written to me only last week. He is in Canada, and he says, "I love you so much. I think of you all the time. I know you are my permanent friend, but I must tell you, I don't believe there's any such country. I don't believe there are any astral planes. I don't believe there's anything inside. But I don't care whether they are not. I'm very happy. I found somebody I can have true love for." He said, "I don't believe anything, but I still love." So a lot of things happen in our own life. But the real discovery of what's going on, what is all this creation about? What is the relationship of creator-creation? How does consciousness come into this picture? And how do we come in as human beings with the capacity to reason, capacity to perceive, capacity to think about these things, capacity to think beyond thoughts, capacity to realize where thoughts have their limitation? That's a great ability. We are not so trapped that we can even see that thoughts have a limitation, that the thoughts cannot go beyond time and space, that thoughts have a duration, that thoughts cannot explain some events that take place in our own life. With all that knowledge, we are very well equipped to explore spiritual truths. And that is how we should be able to look at it. And depending upon how keen we are, how interested we are, the faster is our pace on the spiritual path. We'll take a little break. I'll continue with questions tomorrow again in the afternoon. As you indicated to me, many of you would like to meditate with me. How many of you would still like to meditate after all this discussion? Oh, I'm very happy. We'll reassemble at 3:00 and meet again. Thank you.